Okay. Many thanks for coming back after a drink. We appreciate that. We're sorry about the inequalities of drink. We've got special agreement with the library. We can only drink on stage, and unfortunately, you're not allowed on stage. I'll make sure of that. Okay. What we'd like to do now is obviously mix things up a little bit. I'm going to say a few words about Alex's, what I think, very stimulating and exciting talk tonight. And then also I'm going to ask a few questions of the panel, but also ask the panel to reflect a little with their expertise and backgrounds on some of the items and issues that have been mentioned this evening already. I shall introduce everyone on the panel in a second. But before I do that and turn over to the panel, I'd just like to say a few words as another health social scientist. Even though I'm professor of public health, I have a PhD in health sociology, and I do a lot of sociology work with Alex and other people around the country. And I've got some things to say about that talk, which I suppose are fairly big picture within the discipline of sociology. This is a TARSA public lecture as much as anything else. And that's to say, it's so exciting and very rewarding to hear of research being done using social science perspectives, using sociology, which is highly impactful and translational in its orientation. And what do I mean by that garbled sentence? Well, what I mean is we are thinking reflectively and critically in such a talk as this that Alex has provided, but it's also got practical application. It's about thinking not just about the discipline of sociology, but its role within multidisciplinary research and solving health problems through thinking multidisciplinary. And on that point, I'd just like to congratulate Alex. I think that was a very stimulating and thought-provoking talk. Just to recap there, obviously, Alex is giving us not only a historical overview, but also talked about the culture of prescribing, a diverse cast of actors who have been involved, at least as a focus of his research and the research team of other people who've been mentioned as well. What we'll do now is, before I say too much more about that, I'll enter into another observation or line of thinking in a minute. But first I'd like to introduce you to you some of our panel here, all our panel here, which I have to say we're very, very excited and we're very privileged to have a nice cross-section of people from with great expertise, but in very different, as I mentioned, multidisciplinary backgrounds. So at the very end there, and this is in no particular order, only how they're sat, I shall try and keep these introductions fairly brief. A couple of people have told me, don't say too much about me, please, John. Let's just get on with the issues. I think that's important. But it's good for you to know the context and what kind of positions these people hold. So on the end here, we have another researcher, Professor Nick Graves, who's Professor of Health Economics at Queensland University of Technology. Nick's also Director of an NHMRC Centre of Research Excellence in Reducing Healthcare-Associated Infections. He has a joint appointment in the Institute of Biomedical and Health Innovation in the School of Public Health at QUT and the Centre for Healthcare-Related Infection Control and Surveillance at Queensland Health. Nick is Academic Director of the Australian Centre for Health Services Innovation, and he's also Academic Director for the Centre of Research Excellence in Reducing Healthcare-Associated Infections. I could say many, many more things about Nick, but as you're going to hear with all these panel members, they're pretty much on top of this issue, and they have their own expertise, which we're very grateful for tonight. Also next to Nick, we have Jennifer Broom, Dr. Jennifer Broom, who is a senior staff specialist in infectious diseases and clinical director of antimicrobial stewardship in the Sunshine Coast Hospital and Health Service up in Queensland, and also a senior lecturer at the University of Queensland. Jennifer has a broad research experience from PhD in immunology to designing and implementing randomized investigator-driven multi-center clinical trials, and as you've already heard tonight, has been intimately involved in the program that Alex has also presented tonight. Next to Jennifer, we have Tom Gottlieb, who is Dr. Tom Gottlieb, who is the president of the Australian Society for Antimicrobials. Tom is the current president of the Australian Society and immediate past president of the Australian Society for Infectious Diseases. He's on the executive of the Australian Group on Antimicrobial Resistance. I can see my second wine is going to really catch me here. He represents ASA on the Antimicrobial Resistance Standing Committee, reporting to the Australian government. He's been chair of advisory committees supervising training in infectious diseases and microbiology, and has participated in the writing groups for the Australian Infection Control Guidelines and Therapeutic Guidelines for Antibiotic. And finally, but not least, excluding Alex, who you've already been introduced to, we have Associate Professor Karin Thursky, who's a practicing infectious diseases physician with appointments at Royal Melbourne Hospital and Peter MacCallum Cancer Centre, and is an honorary fellow of the University of Melbourne Medical School. Karin is the clinical director of Guidance, an antimicrobial stewardship program, which she developed with her team at the Royal Melbourne Hospital, and which has been implemented in over 50 hospitals across Australia. Karin has been actively involved in mixed method research through a number of grants looking at models of stewardship in rural, regional, and private hospitals. And she's also a member of the Australian Commission of Quality and Safety in Healthcare Antimicrobial Stewardship Committee, and was instrumental in the development of the national accreditation standards introduced into hospitals in 2013. So, they're the introductions to our panel members. One thing that struck me about the talk, and which I think, if you don't need another introduction, do you, Alex? I think everyone knows who you are. One of the things, standing up here with everyone else sat down, I don't want this attention to be about me directing this, but I'd like to facilitate at least the first question, which is, before we move on to the reflections of each and every one of you about some of the issues that were raised by Alex in that talk from your particular perspectives and expertise, I wonder if we could ponder something that occurred to me throughout the talk, which was the role of patients in thinking about this challenge that we face. We've spoken a lot about interpersonal relationships, the culture of prescribing. We've looked at a diverse range of health professionals and other stakeholders. But I wonder if anyone would like to say a few words about what the potential role and influence could be of patients themselves, particularly given that we have a very mixed audience tonight. Anyone in particular like to take me up on that? Or shall I have to designate someone?
I'm happy to start off.
Jennifer, thank you.
There are always two players in a consultation between a doctor and a patient, and both of those have influence on antibiotic prescribing. You can go to your doctor asking for an antibiotic, or you can go to your doctor asking, do I really have to have an antibiotic? And I think those are two different perspectives. You may not know whether you have a viral or a bacterial infection. Sometimes your doctor may not know, and there are always grey zones where you could be prescribed it or you could hold off. And this is obviously talking maybe more about primary care and the influence of patients in primary care. But I think you can always go with an open mind to your doctor and see it as a legitimate and a therapeutic option to not treat with antibiotics. And I think people often feel ripped off if they go to the doctor and they pay their GP charge and they come away without a prescription. But maybe if you can see the collateral damage that you may get with antibiotics, you might see that as a positive thing. Well, that's great, I don't need a prescription today. So maybe we can shift our thinking so that we go to the doctor with maybe a different kind of perspective than we have previously. Don't know if anyone else wants.
I'm going to switch to the hospital setting now, because patients are very different in hospital. You're pretty disempowered, I'd say, compared to the general practice. We generally have a relationship with the GP. If you're a surgical patient and the surgeon wants you out quick so you can get the next one in, I've got two anecdotes. One anecdote was a cardiothoracic unit, and I went in there, I was doing my antibiotic rounds, and there was a patient on antibiotics, and we called the registrar over and said, oh, why have you got them on, vancomycin and ceftriaxone? And they said, oh, we're treating for a sternal wound infection, which is a terrible complication of open heart surgery. And I said, have you told the patient that? They said, oh, no. I said, does a patient know that the surgeon thinks that he's got a deep sternal wound infection, he's going to be sent home on months of antibiotics? No. I said, well, I'm just warning you that very soon there are going to be requirements for every doctor to have open disclosure about why they're put on antibiotic. We're going to call them national clinical standards. All doctors are going to have to be able to discuss the options of why they're on the antibiotic, what are the possible side effects. My second anecdote, which quickly changed practice, quick smart, was one of the worst prescribers. I hope you don't mind if I bag a few specialists in the room. But respiratory doctors are terrible. They'd say, oh, we're going to bring them in for a tune-up. Truly, they call them tune-ups. And so these patients with cystic fibrosis or bronchiectasis, you know, bad pus lung diseases, are brought in for 2 weeks of antibiotics. And they were giving them these antibiotics. One of them is called gentamicin, which is a very toxic antibiotic. In fact, it can permanently impair your balance, so their lives are ruined. They can't stand, and it never goes away. So we had this joint meeting. It's one of the things we try and do is to change behaviour by changing, you know, knowledge. So we had this joint meeting with the infectious disease and the respiratory doctors, and we talked about other options. You don't necessarily have to bring them in on 10 days of this gentamicin. And we said to them, are you consenting your patients? Are you telling them that they could actually have this lifelong impairment of their balance? And they just looked at us and went, didn't say anything, because we knew that they hadn't. Let me tell you, their practice immediately changed, and never again have they gone to using 10 days of aminoglycoside. And that was directly because I think there has been a bit of a culture shift, Alex, in that we are much more open about talking about patient safety as a driver for what we do. And the best hospitals around the world are the ones where we talk about patient safety. And if you can bring it back to the patient, I think that is one way to change behaviour. And that there are a couple of examples which I hope will, you know, highlight that.
I wonder if we could, thank you. Has anyone else got any comments on that particular? Nick, would you like to?
I'd say with the patient, we're suffering from what I call enormous market failure. The patient demands much too much antibiotics for a couple of reasons. It might be that they've got poor information, and so they demand inappropriately, but also the price is far too low. And if we could give the patient the correct information and charge them the correct price, then it may be that we get a much more appropriate or market clearing level of antibiotics used. At the moment, the information's all wrong, and the market failure is causing us to oversupply and undervalue the commodity. So that's sort of an economist's take on the patient role in this.
Well, Nick, that leads me quite nicely to another question I'd like to put to you first, and then we can talk about this in the panel with other expertise. But Alex mentioned quite nicely some of the cost implications. He touched on the economics slightly of some of this in terms of, if you like, this challenge that we're going to face. From your perspective and your expertise, why could you embellish for us, why should we think about costs when we think about antibiotics and prescribing? What from your position is probably some of the more salient points that we need to think about?
Can I change my Dorothy Dixon, which I mentioned with you earlier, change the word cost to economics, so why should we think about economics?
Sure.
So I think antibiotics have some special economic features. The main one is that they're a non-renewable resource, so they're very similar to gas or coal in the ground. You've only got one go at using it. You can enjoy the benefits of it now, and there won't be any in the future, or you can save it up and dig it up more slowly and not have the benefits now, but enjoy the benefits in the future. So they've got a special personality, if you like, as an economic resource. And also replacing them are uncertain. Replacements are uncertain, so we've got wind and solar, but we're uncertain about the value, the benefits, the effectiveness of that. Same with antibiotics, so they're very similar to non-renewable resources. So they've got some special features, and that leads to some serious economic problems. You know, the first is that as we use them now, doctors and patients, as we use them now, we're facing the wrong price. We're facing much too low a price. A course of antibiotics may be $50, when really the true price may be $8,000 or $12,000 or $16,000. We don't really know what that price is. But the correct price needs to reflect all the healthcare services and benefits we can't deliver in future time periods discounted to today, which is a bit complicated. But when we can't do hip replacements and we can't do cardiac surgery in 20 years' time, there's going to be enormous economic cost, which we should be paying for now, and we're simply escaping those costs. So that's one problem. If we could find the true price, if we could charge $12,000 for a course of antibiotics rather than whatever, $30, it would have two things. It would mean that we used a lot less of them.
I would say.
A good thing. But it would also be a strong signal for innovation. The market would respond, and drug companies would think, whoa, this stuff is valuable. We need to innovate in R&D. We need to make new antibiotics because look how valuable they are. And we're failing to signal the current value of our antibiotics. That leads to, this is the final point, the third point. First was some economic, special economic features. The second was some economic problems. The third point is some regulation problems. So how do we find the correct price? You know, there's data we don't have, data we can't collect that we need to have in order to establish an appropriate price. And then how do we get people to pay it? But really, that's sort of economic theory. We're never going to know the price, and we're never going to get people to pay the correct price, which is frustrating. So we need to find other ways of changing preferences for antibiotics, and that's the challenge I think that we all face. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
I wonder if we could just move to someone else in the panel who could give us a reflection on some of the social dynamics and the culture of prescribing that Alex has mentioned in hospitals. Tom, would you like to say a few words about any issues that struck you out of Alex's talk?
Okay, there's so many things to reflect on. So one thing, maybe I'll take a slightly different cue on, and that is to say, maybe we're thinking about antibiotics as something that we can preserve forever. Maybe we should be nihilistic and accept the fact that we might lose antibiotics completely, and that is not an unexpected event. Maybe the antibiotic era that we treasure was just a blip in history. When we look back in 500 years' time, it was just an accident waiting to happen. It was never going to last. Because it's a serendipitous discovery that is now failing. And I guess my thought is that into the future, what we need to discover is other products, which may be called antibiotics or something else, that may attack the targets, which are bacteria in this instance. And what we're trying to do in the short term is just preserve the antibiotic era just that little bit longer while those other products come into it. And hence the point is, it's innovation. Humans innovate very well. We've got fantastic molecular sciences. We should be able to make those products into the future. They might be called something else. But as a society, if we're going to innovate, we have to put money into those innovations. And I think that's where there's a political agenda missing. I think we need leadership to be able to create those new products, which we desperately need. And I think there'll be a gap in the future where we'll be losing antibiotics before we have the new products coming. So that's one reflection, slightly nihilistic. As far as the behaviour aspect, I'll make two other points. I think they've been made well enough, but I think behaviour is an issue because you can see some of us are advocates for the patients, or at least think we are advocates for the patients, and we think we want to preserve the patient's life, or sometimes just maybe preserve them from getting an infection at all costs. And that means people use antibiotics at the earliest particular convenience. And then there's the other people who are probably societal advocates, and we say, look, we should preserve those antibiotics, we shouldn't use them at once. And there's a gulf between the two views, and they're very hard to bring together. One anecdote I had recently is I had a relative in my family who had some skin cancer surgery on their face, and I was shocked to see that the surgeon then prescribed 7 days of oral antibiotics afterwards. There's no indication, there's no evidence for doing it, but he was doing it because he wanted the best possible outcome. And everyone is faced with the idea of doing the best possible thing. And I guess the adage, I think there's the road to hell is paved with good intention. And if the road to hell is losing antibiotics, it's often paved by people wanting to do the right thing all the time, but not realizing that they're sacrificing our antibiotics into the future. I guess the third comment I was going to make is that we all hope that better guidance and better education is going to change people's behavior, but I'm sometimes fearing it won't. I don't see great changes in attitudes to antibiotics despite a lot of effort into education. And I feel that if anything is going to work down the line, it's probably regulation rather than education. And there are examples where regulation has worked. Certainly in Australia, we have regulated a certain class of antibiotics called the quinolones from veterinary practice, and we've regulated it from being easily available in the community. And when you look at our quinolone resistance rates, they're very low in the community relative to the rest of the world. So it tells us that if you control certain antibiotics, you can stop resistance developing. And therefore, we needed to take it back to leadership. If we can't stop people prescribing, we need to regulate things just that little bit better.
Okay. Thank you, Tom. So I wonder if we could just move a step down from that then. So that's many of those issues are regulation in particular are fairly macro and big picture. But I mean, just going back to what Alex was saying about the culture of local clinical practice, the culture of prescribing, the culture of professional approaches to medicine and healthcare. I wonder if particularly we could talk with Karin and Jennifer, who are involved at different levels and in different ways in different places with the stewardship program, and how things that are currently being implemented at the moment, nationally I know in some regard, but also these are very localized programs in different hospital settings. Karin in particular, but then also Jennifer, I wonder if you could say a few words about what Alex's talk provides you in terms of...
Just before I start though, can I have a show of hands who knows what stewardship means? So pretty educated audience.
Some people don't have their hand up, however.
No. So this is a problem. Alex alluded to it, trying to explain to people what it actually is. And there's no, I think I'm right, there's no translation of the languages, is there? It's widely used in UK, US and Australia. And in fact, the publications about stewardship only came in the sort of early 90s, so it's a relatively new thing. But it's not just confined to antibiotics. So there is actually a Red Cross stewardship service, did you know? Same. And other groups like endocrinologists are starting to use this term. And basically what it is a series of processes to try and improve practice in order to, I guess, promote best prescribing and ultimately lead to better patient safety and then reduce resistance. Now, in reality, in the hospitals, I don't run around saying, I'm doing stewardship because there's going to be less resistance in the future. You know, like some saviour. I sell it as, if you prescribe antibiotics properly, your patient is going to have less complications, they're going to get out of hospital earlier, and you're going to save lives. Now, having said that, I completely agree with a lot of what Alex has said, because at the end of the day, you've got junior residents and consultants and surgeons who don't know what the hell they're doing with antibiotics. It's not like writing up paracetamol for an ache, 500 milligrams QID. It's not that. And the terrible thing is that the most commonly prescribed antibiotic in Australia, which is called ceftriaxone, is 1 gram IV daily. It is so easy to write up. It's prescribed. We did a national survey of antibiotic use last year. We had 13,000 prescriptions. 7,000 of those prescriptions in hospitals was ceftriaxone. Ceftriaxone itself is a dollar a day, and it is probably the worst antibiotic for triggering issues like Clostridium difficile, a terrible diarrheal illness associated with antibiotics, and resistance in our gram negatives, you know, really a driver of a massive, huge problem all over the world. So I don't consider us an island. We're part of a world problem here. So I have to work with the premise that actually I know that the doctors don't know what they're doing, and they don't, because half of every prescription is not appropriate. So what we've done, our team anyway at the Melbourne, I'll give you another anecdote before I step into what it is, because it was actually very interesting. When, in 1999, when I started off doing our research here, I read this article in the New England Journal about this antibiotic assistant program. I thought, wow, this is fantastic. Let's get it. And I contacted them and said, well, we can't actually translate out of the hospital. It's part of Intermountain Health and we can't move it out. It's in this strange language. But you can buy the data dictionary, which is $750,000. I said, oh, okay. So I thought, maybe I'll try and do something. So what I decided to do was I was going to write these very complex, clever, you know, decision support algorithms for prescribing. Very quickly, I realised guidelines were not going to work. So what I did next was, and this is one of the best things I've ever done, is I put in a human factors engineer, so someone who understands how humans can best interact with technology, computers, who is also a psychologist, into the intensive care unit at the Royal Melbourne, and I put him in there for 3 months. And I said, I want you to spend 3 months in the intensive care and then come out and tell me how antibiotic decisions are made. And if you ever look at the paper, it's hilarious. There's a flow chart of lines going. It was absolute chaos. The second part was, well, if I was going to give them something that was going to help them prescribe, what would it be? So again, we went through various prototypes, and you know, this spent over weeks and months. You know what they wanted? The poor old residents were spending 2 hours a day trying to get microbiology results so that when they did the ward rounds with the consultants, they had something to make a decision about. All they wanted was good results. So what I did was, I actually got this fantastic programmer and another programmer that essentially hacked into the pathology system, but I never told the executive that. And we created a real-time microbiology browser, so at any particular time we get this line, date, bug, sensitivities, if there are no sensitivities, the sort of antibiogram. And I did develop some simple recommendations, but I don't think they use it that much. But just with having an effective microbiology browser that they trusted, that they could tick their fingers, they knew what was happening, so that if, you know, after a week they didn't have any positive cultures, that reduced broad spectrum prescribing by 30%. That's all, and that was, I think, directly due to having better results presented to them at the bedside, not rocket science. The next step was, well, that's okay, I see it as a special situation, what do we do in the wards? And this is where we sort of came up with this process, which has turned into guidance, which is this program. But really what it is a role-based program. So we know that the doctors don't really know what they're doing, but we need to know what they're doing. So guidance actually tells us, or where, when it's implemented, who is on what antibiotic, in what ward, for what indication. If they are on a drug, is it one of the ones that we really need to keep an eye on? And if it isn't for an indication, they might not know what it is yet, but sometimes they do, and we need to know if those ones are serious. A good example is, we definitely want to know within 24 hours if a patient's got meningitis somewhere that may not have been referred to the infection service. We also want to know which patients are on these so-called restricted antibiotics. So the way guidance works, it's what we call it assistive technology. It's, if you can imagine the magnitude of 40% of patients in a hospital on antibiotics and 50% of their inappropriate, that's a hell of a lot of antibiotics to keep a tab on. And they're only usually the intravenous ones. There's a whole lot of very simple oral antibiotics that are thrown around. We call it under the radar use. So it is a lot of work to run a stewardship program, and in fact they're expensive. And if I'm sure that most of my colleagues having to start up stewardship programs are faced with executives that say, I want you to reduce money, I want you to reduce the cost of the antibiotics. And we say to them, well, that you're barking up the wrong tree, because if I'm going to switch from Keftraxa, which is 1 gram a day, to another antibiotic that's 30, I might cost you more money. This is why we've had to really push the patient's safety as a focus.
And I think that's why, just very quickly, with Jennifer, if you could comment on sutures, because you're involved in those too, I know, in terms of, I'm just wondering the engagement of the type of issues that Alex has talked about, the culture of prescribing, professional practice, and how we might learn and reassess and refine stewardship programs or add to them in some way to get to factor in those elements that maybe haven't been thought of until now.
Yeah, so we're, I guess, at the beginning of stewardship rather than further along like Karin is in Melbourne on the Sunshine Coast. So we started at the end of 2012. And I guess I'd just like to take a bit of a step back and say that, you know, there are many cross-cultural differences between antibiotic prescribing. So if you look at, for example, countries in Europe, There'll be countries that prescribe, you know, three times as many antibiotics as other countries. And it's not all about computer systems and things. Some of it is about your cultural tolerance of uncertainty, your hierarchy structures within your cultures. There are a lot of different aspects that influence prescribing that are really, really important. And I guess when I started, I thought, oh, well, I just need to tell people, very naively, I just need to tell people the guidelines and then they'll follow them. And how foolish that was, because people actually don't read the guidelines, they don't access them, they don't know where they are on the web. And I thought, oh yeah, we'll just put in guidance. Oh, well, we don't have the computer systems, how are we going to get the money for it? You know, all this kind of thing. So there are those institutional issues, but then I also wanted to ask a quick, because as clinicians, sometimes we're at fault because we say, I know, I'll do this and I'll see if this happens. Now, where social science can help us is they can say, well, was that the right question to be asking? So actually, when you step back, and what was really interesting to me from when we started to get the social data was that the things that I thought would work actually were nothing to do with the decision making at all. And actually, so what I've started to do is implement in my antimicrobial stewardship education. I go to them and I talk about, some stewardship programs, they try to be the antibiotic police or the antibiotic control people. And what that does is tells the doctor that they're wrong. And I guess what I do is I try and tell them in which that way they're right, in which way they're trying really hard to do their best for the patient. Because that's what they believe. They believe that they're doing the best thing for their patient. And for me to come and say, no, you're a bad doctor, actually all it does is alienate them from me and makes them alienated from the stewardship process. So what was most important from the research for me was to show that actually they were doing the right thing, but it was just having the wrong outcomes. So they were doing the right thing by caring for the patient, by caring for their colleagues, by caring for their professional relationships. But unfortunately, all that was going wrong in terms of the outcome. And I've actually found people are very, very receptive to that process. It is very time consuming. As Karin said, I don't believe stewardship is cost saving. I think stewardship, antibiotic stewardship, is very time and emotion intensive, and there is a lot of energy you need to put into it. Sorry, I'm very long answer there, but I think that social theory and social research can give us a place to start where we might think that it was a different place we should be starting, but it can actually show us what's really going on.
So I think from that, what I take as a sociologist is the power of rethinking, critical thinking from outside the clinical and medical sphere, adding new multidisciplinary perspectives to trying to approach this problem. And I think in a sense, if I may be overstating my MC role here, but I think it sounds to me very loud and clear that the journey of this, adding in the social science perspective and gloss on this, has started. And I think probably the next step is to work out how to move further towards implementation and impact, the very transition of how do you... We can elaborate on some of the qualitative work that's been done here to really expose certain cultural dimensions to this issue. What's also equally important for all of us, particularly, of course, people in the not only in the healthcare system, but the patients themselves, is how do you then translate that into changing the culture and doing something and responding to the challenges. I wonder if now, I can see I'm getting an evil eye from Alex. I'm just wondering about time in terms of Q&A, and probably now is a good time to move over to Q&A. Would anyone from the floor